Well, now we've seen the chase. Can we unfasten our seat belts for a minute? Has any film you've worked on at least had a stronger, more accelerated opening than this?
No. That was the intent, actually, too. Yeah. We wanted to come in the middle of another film.
I mean, it's like we go into hyperdrive. Now, coming out of it, we can get our breath and start to examine the anatomy of a chase scene like this. Or should we call it a second unit sequence? I mean, what is the terminology for a scene like that?
Yeah, a chase sequence. I mean, originally it was scheduled as a second unit chase, which meant I would have sent out a second unit director and a whole second unit crew, and they would have brought back dailies, and I would have looked at it and said, redo this, do that. But since we started it 2 weeks before we started the picture, second unit was done by first unit people. And I had Mel there, and I had Danny there, although I only used them in a couple of shots there. I had them there to feel what was going on and get involved in the beginning of the picture.
So let's go back then and follow it from the inception.
Okay.
The chase begins where? In somebody's mind.
Somewhere. Yeah, the chase, strangely enough, started in my mind because draft after draft of the picture started out what we call Morris the Explainer. Started out as a scene where we found out through Danny and Mel what had happened to their lives and where they were, and they soon, and it was a drag, it was a bore. and it became a sequel, and I didn't want it to be a sequel, I wanted it to be an action piece of a continuing saga in their lives. And so I said to Jeffrey Bohm, or Joel, I forget, why don't we come in the middle of something, like a chase? And Jeff caught into it instantly, and so he sat down, and I said the one thing I really wanted to introduce in the chase was that they're back, and they're the Bickersons, and they've been married too long, and they've been sitting in the same car too long, and Danny still won't let Mel drive because he's senior driver, a senior officer. And Jeff came up with the idea. He said, why don't we have him driving his wife's new car? I said, oh, fantastic. And so it evolved.
A station wagon.
Yes, they're in a station wagon.
Now, at this point, I suppose you're restricted to looking at blueprints, maps, street maps of
LA.
Well,
we decided to shoot it at night because shooting in LA during the day, I wanted to make it first Christmas rush hour day, a chase in LA, which would have been a terrific chase. I mean, because you had jammed up cars and people all over, and we could have gone the most devious route in the world, but it became prohibitive.
Yeah.
We couldn't have afforded it, and the city wouldn't permit it. So then we transposed it tonight, which meant the city streets opened up to us. The city fathers, the LAPD, made it available to us, and we were able to do it. So we went downtown and looked for what we thought were fairly visual areas, relative postcard shots, but within a chase you could feel the city that you were living in.
But so far, it's still only in your head.
Still here. Well, totally in the head. And then when I decided on areas, I sent Jeff Bohm down with the stunt coordinators, the stunt drivers, the guys who are actually going to drive the cars. And I said, okay, now you guys go figure out a chase, a visual chase, which they did. And they brought a storyboard artist with them.
Uh-huh.
And they storyboarded the whole thing. And I'd look at it, and we'd change this, and Jeff would add a little of that.
Have you ever done storyboards yourself?
No.
But you have a person.
I'll tell you a story about storyboards and how this comes into this. Years ago, I was doing The Omen. And there was a major scene in it. It was my first major motion picture. And there was a scene where the baboons in the Windsor Safari Park attack the car because the Antichrist is in it, the child is in it. And I said, wow, this is going to be really difficult. I said, don't worry, we'll get a storyboard guy in. We'll work this all out with the animal handlers and everything. And we sat and we drew for weeks, and I approved, disapproved, everything. It was great. Finally got this great sequence down. And I sat with the animal handlers, and I sat with the drivers, and I sat with the actors and actresses, and I especially sat with the stunt people, I sat with all the coordinators, and everybody's got it, yeah, let's go, man. And we went in that first morning at 7:30 in the morning, and camera goes here, that goes there, B camera there, C camera there, A camera there, let's go, all right, roll, let the baboons out. 100 baboons came out, and not one of them understood the storyboards. And they got thrown out, man, and I, in a state of panic, decided I had to learn to improvise. And that's exactly what happened. Well, that's exactly what happened on the chase. We developed it, we built it, we had it all on paper, we knew what we were going to do, and then you get down there, and then there's a spin around that looks better, or that an accident happens there by mistake, and I wanted the tunnel, and you start to improvise, and You just make sure in your own mind you're cutting as you go, so you've covered all the pieces. I originally was going to do all the interior shots of Mel and Danny with a camera car pulling the other car and do all the dialogue. And I realized, I can't do that. It'll take me weeks and weeks and weeks just to do the dialogue. So we tried something I hate, and that's interior process.
Right.
But Stephen Goldblatt, the DP, who's a brilliant cameraman, we tried a lot of new formulas for interior process, and I defy anybody to look at that chase and say they can see process.